Hi guys, I am here with Stefan Jansson, professor of plants and...
Plant, cell and molecular biology.
It is a mouthful.
Yep.
So let's start by talking about your path to science. When did you know you were going to go into science?
In the spring of 1986, I know very well, because I didn't study biology in order to become a scientist. I'm trained as a teacher, so I was going to the teachers' college. And back in the 80s, that was education was organized a little bit differently than it is now. So at that time, it was the same, and we who were to become teachers, we were taking the same courses as the biologists and the chemists. So I was about to finish as a teacher after these years. Yeah. Then I was asked, in fact, by one of the professors over here whether I would like to start as a PhD student, because my wife at that time, she was, had just started as a PhD student. I thought many times that maybe they just took me because they didn't want to lose her. But so then I started as a PhD student in 86.
Yeah.
And my research question at that time was to see whether I could sequence a gene from a tree.
Yeah.
Because at that time that was not done.
No.
This was just at the birth of plant molecular biology. So, and that's why I became a molecular biologist. Otherwise, of course, from interest, I would have looked at, I was doing a lot of botany and ornithology and so, so maybe I should have gone that way instead, but I became a molecular biologist. I was really deeply into molecular biology for the first 10 or 15 years. But then, eventually, when over time you develop, you can get more resources to decide what you want to do yourself. So then I, for the last almost 20 years, more and more of the research I've been doing is getting back more into nature.
Yeah.
Trying to combine sort of the molecular work that we've been doing in the lab with the work that we have been, with something which is relevant for nature.
Yeah.
And that was really the reason, the big step towards that. That's why we decided to start to study that tree over there.
Should we go and look at that tree?
Yep. I thought I should do something where you can look at the interaction between the genes and the metabolites and all these things with something happening in nature. And then an obvious thing was to look, for me at that time, look at autumn leaves, to look at trees that get turned yellow in the autumn.
Yeah.
And because and then we had this aspen, or everyone knows that trees in the autumn, they get the yellow leaves. And at that time, no one had a clue, really, how do they understand this? How do they know when autumn is coming? And how? But I thought we need to understand the leaves as well. That's why we started on this tree, and first of all to sequence genes in thousands and thousands and thousands. Later on trying to see how the genes were regulated over
the
season.
Time of year.
And eventually trying to understand how they know when to start having them getting the yellow in the autumn there. Spring is driven by temperature.
Yeah.
That's so well known. That's why in a warm spring leaves come earlier. But autumn is not, and that's important.
It's
thing.
Not.
So this particular tree, it starts getting yellow leaves on September 10 every year, regardless of the weather.
Is that true?
Yeah, and that was sort of the original observation, started to see how can they know that it's September 10 and not September 5 or September 15? Because weather is different from year to year.
Yeah.
So what is really what signals do they respond to, and how is this translated into starting a biochemical process at this degradation of the leaf content and so on. It's the main way that we deal is dealing with natural variation.
Yeah.
Because if you have other trees, they start, as you say, in.
Yeah.
If you would bring a tree from southern Sweden here and put it there, which we have in a common garden over there, then all these trees, they start later in the autumn to have the yellow leaves because they adapted to other conditions. So, and this is decided by the genes. They really respond to something in the environment, which has to be light, that's clear.
Yeah.
Because it cannot be temperature. The only thing which is constant over the years, that's light. We used to believe that it was only day length, because when trees setting bud in the autumn. Yeah. That is driven by day length. We don't think, or it doesn't fit the data to say that it's only, so that something else is in here. But it's, we all know there are other things. You can have a look at this, for instance. This is what we did. You can see if they can. This we did 10 years ago.
You took the bark off.
We took the bark off this stem. Because this is the same tree.
Yeah.
And now they have the common root system. So that means that you can strip the bark off. So this has been here now for 10 years. And then we, of course, then you can compare leaves on this stem with leaves of this stem too. And then these ones are getting the yellow leaves earlier than these ones.
So there is something.
So there is something also inside the tree that can sort of overrule these things. And there are some other things that happen as well. You can have a look here and see there are some of the branches have flowers.
Yeah. Those, not all of them though.
Not all of them. But those that have flowers, they are those that
are coming from
that one.
The strip tree.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So that induces flowering to much higher extent as well. So we know another thing that is influencing this, that's sort of the amount of nutrition that they are getting.
Yeah.
So if you, because the purpose of having yellow leaves in the autumn, that is to salvage nitrogen and other things, because otherwise they will freeze and then they will drop down.
And then disappear and not benefit.
And then, I mean, of course it will, these leaves will degrade and then you would, so this might get the nitrogen back.
Yeah.
But it could also fall there, and then this tree may get it, and so then it loses this.
Yeah.
So that's the whole purpose of doing it. But we also know that you can, to some extent, fertilize away
the greenery
The lawn is quite okay here. There was one year, I think it was 2011 or 2012, when the university decided to remake the lawn. So then they took away the grass here. They put fertilizers and put the new soil and all. And that year, the tree was actually affected. It started degrading chlorophyll at the same time, but it went much slower because then it was not so much under nitrogen deprivation as the other years.
So it senses what it needs.
Yep.
But is that sort of what drives you, like seeing sort of the molecular biology in action almost?
At least one of these things. Yeah, no, it's as I say, it is so cool. So this is really my pet project. Been now for 20 years trying to understand it. And make yourself a career in research. It should be something which has a curiosity element. It's always better. But then, of course, it must be important one way or the other.
Yeah.
And senescence is important for trees to some extent, but the way that we have motivated this project all the time is that to say that if you really should understand how you should do genetics in trees, this is probably the best thing to look at, because it's a trait that you could be over there, and then you can score in 10 seconds or in 2 seconds, even if you're 10 year old, you can see whether it has started to senesce or not.
Yeah, because it will go yellow. Yeah. Research questions have on society. Are we just having these for curiosity? Is it basic research just to, we don't know where we'll end up? Or do we actually have an application already?
Application for tree genetics?
Yeah.
That is tremendous. I mean, not with aspen, because we don't grow aspen as a commercial tree in Sweden. Maybe. But the thing is that the pines and spruces that you see over there, they are the basis, more or less, of the economy, at least in this part of the country. So if we can only make spruces that will grow 1% better, that will sort of have an enormous effect on the economy 60 years from now when the trees are cut down. And of course, in order to understand how you should do breeding on trees, pines and spruces, in the best possible way, this is why I can have a project like this on aspen, where everything goes much quicker, much easier and much smoother.
Yeah.
So if we learn how to do it here, then the tree breeders can use these things later on. So this is sort of the motivation. And of course, we know in some cases, we know if we twist this little gene to this extent, you can get trees that may get even more
robust.
More robust. For instance, individual genes that regulate resistance towards individual
like fungal, pesticides
or fungal infections and so on. That's the problem. I mean, this, if you go here in the autumn, I mean, all these leaves, they have a lot of dots with different fungi, and they come different years, come other fungi. There are insects here eating them. So if you can try to reduce these things a little bit,
the stress,
then that could have a big impact in the long run. So these are things that we think we are getting, but as I said, all tree research take a very, very long time, so you need to be patient.
Yeah, because you do notice as you walk up through Sweden, there's a lot of trees.
There is a lot of trees.
There's a lot of farming of trees as well.
I think there are about 4,000 trees per Swede.
And there's about 10 million Swedes, so that's a lot of trees.
And every year there are around 300 million pines and spruces planted every year.
Wow. So it's a big economy.
Yeah. So that if that each of these ones, when they grow up, if they will produce value of only 10 crowns per tree more, that's 3 billion crowns a year.
What impact do you feel that, because we talk a lot about the climate is going to change over, or we are in the middle of a changing period. Does that have an impact on trees? Or are they resilient?
Yeah, no, that has a big impact on trees. And this is also what really implemented already right now in the spruce and pine breeding, because they have to breed for future climate. They know that when this one's going to be harvested, most likely climate will be pretty much milder than now. And if you take to this particular, as I said, this get the leaves on September 10, because it's stupid to keep them longer.
Yeah.
Probably if, I mean, and this is the same, almost every aspen around here, it may differ by a week or so, but pretty much in the middle of September. In 50 years, if climate will be milder here, it would probably be much better if they kept on the leaves for 2 weeks more.
Yeah.
And because then it will grow more every year and grow quicker than the others.
Yeah.
But these ones were really selected long time ago.
Exactly.
When climate was harsher. So this has a really big impact on forests, much more. So it's long-term business.
Of course. But is that something that can be modified genetically? Like not by just selecting what we think, but more directed.
But this is what we are doing. I mean, if we understand which genes that controls this.
Yeah.
Here in Aspen, then of course we know which work, how to fiddle around with them to change one type of the one variety of the gene into another. And then, I mean, we have.
So we could help.
We could help if we want.
Yeah.
That's not the problem. Right now it's not allowed because it's not allowed to use genetically modified trees in for more or less crops or trees whatsoever in Europe. But we could if society wants.
We haven't talked too much of the challenges that there is in the field.
Yeah. No,
what do you think is the big challenge right now in the field?
I mean, we all have the normal scientific challenges. We need to understand things which we don't do, and we need to organize in a way so that we can do it, and we need to get funding. What is a bit particular for us in plant science is what we touched upon before here, that we have this extremely frustrating situation that we know that we could help society so much better.
Yeah.
It's just that we're not allowed to do it. And we plant scientists know that they are not more risky. If anything, the traditional breeding is more risky, because then we don't know what we are doing. We can do the same thing with sort of gene technology, exactly the same differences, and then it's illegal. And if we do the differences without knowing that we have done them, then it's legal.
So, but what is it that then overrides that frustration? Is it just the curiosity?
It's curiosity, and again, the optimism, because it will not be like this forever. I mean, and we can have a lot of fun
inside
as well, in doing all these things, just waiting for things to change.
Yeah. And then you're ready.
Then we're ready.
Amazing. I think I'll let that be our last word.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I will leave some contact so people, if they have questions, mm-hmm. can contact yeah, yeah. you and find mm-hmm. you.
Yep.
And otherwise, just thank you for mm-hmm. coming out for a walk and talk.
Mm-hmm. And it was nice.
It is. Yeah. I like them. Yep. I always get inspired.
Mm-hmm.
Also this time.
Mm-hmm.
So, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, guys.
Bye.